Well, good morning, all.
Good morning.
Good to see you all this morning. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Psalm 119 today. And by the way, when Jackie was talking about all that food from Starbucks, it's not a suggestion. Literally, go and help yourself. And grab something out of those freezers. There is lots there. I'm grateful for ministries that coordinate those things and talk to those organizations. And just look at that freezer and think about the fact that if no one took it, it would be thrown away. Whereas now it has an opportunity to bless others. So, Psalm 119. Again, I keep forgetting my glasses. So bear with me, please. Reading verses 1 to 16. Blessed are those whose ways are blameless, who walk according to the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep his statutes and seek him with all their heart. They do no wrong, but follow his ways. You have laid down precepts that are to be fully obeyed. Oh, that my ways were steadfast in obeying your decrees. Then I would not be put to shame when I consider all your commands. I will praise you with an upright heart as I learn your righteous laws. I will obey your decrees. Do not utterly forsake me. How can a young person stay on the path of purity? By living according to your word. I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Praise be to you, Lord. Teach me your decrees. With my lips I recount all the laws that come from your mouth. I rejoice in following your statutes as one rejoices in great riches. I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways. I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word. May God bless the reading of his word this morning. The inspiration of the Bible is seen in its unique survival. All through history, it has been a hated book for certain people because of its claim to be the word of the living God. But in spite of all attempts, at times by emperors, dictators, and totalitarian governments to destroy it by burning, confiscation, and the imprisonment and persecution of those who read it and preach it, all such attempts have miserably failed. This remarkable book is still with us, as widely dispersed as ever. During the Stalin era in Russia, the Marxist government derided the Bible as a book full of legends, myths, and old wives' tales. It even established an anti-Bible museum in Moscow to try and convince the people. Yet for all their derision, the authorities were so desperately afraid that people would read it and believe it, that they put them in prison and in labor camps for doing so. Why? Because they knew that this unique book had the power to change people's lives. Psalm 119 is this incredible ode to the Word of God. And it's another psalm that's written in an acrostic form. Each section starts with the corresponding letter of the Hebrew alphabet. Now, we don't know who wrote it, but it's an intimate portrait of the relationship between the author and the Lord. There is so much that you can glean from the 176 verses. Literally, you could do a whole series just on Psalm 119. But we're just going to look at the first 16 and talk about those this morning and see what it has to say to us. As the Bridge Community Church, our desire is to help people help connect people to God and to each other. And we do that by first living, which means being a regular worshiper and gathering together as the church family to help live out our faith. Secondly, giving. We give out to others in kindness and love through hospitality, giving back in time, talent, and treasure to support the ministries of the church. Thirdly, teaching. We teach one another about faith by being in small groups or classes together, Sunday school. These are the opportunities where we can learn and share what the Word of God is saying to us. And fourthly, reaching. We reach out to others through and supporting a community ministry as a way to share our faith. We work together through local outreach initiatives like the Senator Buchanan School as a church family, sharing God's love and our faith in creative ways. These areas are what build us as disciples of Jesus. Well, this psalm this morning speaks to one of God's ways in strengthening us as his disciples. And that is by teaching us his truth found in the Bible. It's not hard to pick up on the theme of the first section. It's obedience. Verse 8 says, I will obey your decrees. Do not forsake me. Verses 1 and 2 start out the same way as Psalm 1 happens to start out. Blessed are. We're given two beatitudes by the author. Blessed are those whose ways are blameless, who walk according to the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep his statutes and seek him with all their heart. They do no wrong, but follow his ways. People are blessed for being blameless in the eyes of God. The Hebrew word tamim is also translated as perfect. But theologian W.T. Purkhizer sets us straight on what being blameless means. Biblical perfection is not faultlessness, but blamelessness. It's perfection of heart, not of head or hand. It relates to intention, not intelligence, to love, not life, to purity, not performance. It has to do with deliverance from sin, not from ignorance, mistakes, infirmities, temptations, or the constant necessity for watchfulness and prayer. In other words, we can be made holy or blameless by what God does to our hearts. We're counted as blessed by how we keep the Bible in our lives. Statutes is also translated as testimony. And just as a testimony that might be given by a fellow believer, a fellow follower of Jesus can impact us, can change us, God's testimony given to us through this book can change us. God's law is God's voice to us. And our walk or lifestyle is dictated by the law of the Lord. In other words, we're made blameless by our obedience to God and to his word. For us to live in obedience means we seek God with all of our heart. If we desire to be a holy or blameless people, God needs all of us, all of who we are. A disciple is not partially obedient. We don't pick and choose which parts of Scripture to obey. We embrace all of it. We embrace all of Scripture. And as disciples, we struggle and wrestle with Scripture that we don't understand, and we allow the Holy Spirit to teach us what God is saying. It becomes even clearer to us when we work through it together, either in pairs or in groups. Chris Kelly shares this story. He says, our denomination has a pastor's retreat every year up in the mountains of Southern California. As I was walking to breakfast one morning, I came across a monument that explained that when Billy Graham first started preaching, he was confused and had some doubts about God's word. And while praying one morning, got down on one knee at this monument and he said, Lord, I don't understand all that's in this book, and there are a lot of different passages that I have my doubts about, but you say it's your word, so by faith I'm going to accept it as my authority and live it. That prayer proved to be a turning point of his life, and from that moment on, God began to use him in amazing ways. You have laid down your precepts that are to be fully obeyed. Oh, that my ways were steadfast in obeying your decrees. Then I would not be put to shame when I consider all your commands. Verses 4 to 6. Now, as I mentioned just a moment ago, delayed or partial obedience doesn't exist in following God. We would be considered disobedient. And as our author informs us, sometimes it can be difficult to be consistent in following God's word. He says because of his inconsistency, he feels shame. Now, Scripture does point out our sin to us. Just look at the Ten Commandments, for example. Have you ever lied? Have you ever stolen? Have you ever wanted something that your neighbor had? The letter of James, possibly written by Jesus' brother, said, for whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles at just one point is guilty of breaking all of it. Chapter 2, verse 10. And Paul says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. In Romans 3, 23. So it's clear that the Bible shows how we are separated from God. But the author of Hebrews says this about Scripture. For the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Hebrews 4:12. Now, what I'm going to share, I don't think is exactly what it means, but he says God's word is double-edged. It's an offensive weapon, and it hits us with the truth. But it's also defensive and helps protect us. The Bible tells us we're sinners, but it also shows us how we can be saved. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. John 3:16. Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. John 14:6. If we confess our sins, he, meaning God, is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9. If you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Romans 10:9. And then we have the four Gospels to teach us who this Jesus is and what he has done for us. We aren't left in our sin. We have the opportunity to be rescued and begin our journey towards sanctification. Amen. Let me conclude with some thoughts from verses 9 to 16. How can a young person stay on the path of purity? By living according to your word. It's as if the author has become a teacher in this moment. and is instructing his students in how they can live a good life, a life pleasing to God. Now that verse is no less true today as it was then. Our younger generations are being told they have to think and believe a certain way instead of being taught to think critically about all things. Paul said something similar in his first letter to the Thessalonians. Do not quench the spirit. Do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all. Hold on to what is good. Reject every kind of evil. 1 Thessalonians 5, 19b to 22. God speaks through his word, and God speaks through his people. Paul encourages to not completely dismiss what others say, but to test it. Well, how do we test it? We see if what they say agrees with Scripture. God will never call us to go against something he has declared in the Bible. And Paul follows up by saying that reject everything that is evil. Well, how do we know what is evil? Again, we hold it up against what is said in Scripture. If all of us, not just our younger generations, want to stay pure, we need to be students of the Bible. We need to meditate on it, which means that we reflect on what we're reading and what God might be saying to us. We hide God's word in us by reading and memorizing verses. And we ask the Holy Spirit to teach us as we read God's message to us and to our world. The Bible helps us in our church's mission to teach one another. We learn what the truth is. That we are sinners until we accept what Jesus has done for us, rescuing us from our sinful past and restoring us as sons and daughters of God. And we discover the pathway to becoming blameless or pure through careful study and obedience of what God teaches through this incredible book. Let me finish this with this wonderful description of the Bible that was given by Dr. Larry Petten. What is the Bible? This book contains the mind of God, the state of man, the way of salvation, the doom of sinners, and the happiness of believers. Its doctrines are holy, its precepts are binding, its histories are true, and its decisions are immutable. Read it to be wise, believe it to be safe, and practice it to be holy. It contains light to direct you, food to support you, and comfort to cheer you. It is the traveler's map, the pilgrim's staff, the pilot's compass, the soldier's sword, and the Christian's character. Here, paradise is restored, heaven opened, and the gates of hell disclosed. Christ is its grand object. Our good is its design, and the glory of God its end. It should fill the memory, rule the heart, and guide the feet. Read it slowly, frequently, and prayerfully. It is given you in life and will be opened in judgment and will be remembered forever. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for your word this morning. We thank you for the gift of the Holy Scriptures. We thank you, God, for how this Bible was put together for us, how it has brought life and life everlasting for over 2,000 years. Maybe even longer, God, when you think about the history of the Old Testament and how lives were changed. Lord God, I think the Bible today is still derided to some degree, still thought of as fanciful, still ignored, and yet we know there is power. There's power in reading those words. If we're willing to listen, if we're willing to hear the message. So God, I thank you for how your message has impacted us. How it is by way of the Holy Spirit changed all of our lives. And Lord, I fully know there are times where we don't get it. We don't understand. We don't grasp everything that you might be saying. And I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would continue to help us in understanding. And I pray, Lord, we would not give up meeting together to talk about it. That we would not give up meeting together, whether it's over coffee with somebody or in a Sunday school class or in a small group, that we would continue to desire to learn and grow as your disciples. And Lord God, there's a whole world out there that that either hasn't heard it or has ignored it. And I pray your message would still go out. Your message would still go out through your people, whether it's to neighbors, whether it's as missionaries or preachers, whether it's in our places of work. God, I pray that you would continue to use this book to transform others. Thank you. Thank you, Lord, for this morning. And I pray you will continue to be with us here as we worship together. In Jesus' name, amen.